Good evening, and welcome to this celebration of Good Friday with Union Congregational, United Church of Christ. Good Friday is the day that Christians commemorate Jesus' betrayal, trial, and crucifixion. Our service tonight is called Tenebrae, which means shadows. As each reader offers their scripture reading, they will extinguish their candles and their cameras, symbolizing the disciples' betrayal and desertion as Jesus, the light of the world, was executed. You are welcome to follow along in the bulletin that was emailed to everyone in our database. If you would like to start receiving these communications, contact the church office. As we sing our first two hymns, we invite you to find a candle or other source of light, light it as you reflect and pray about what you would like to leave at Jesus' feet. Let us pray. God of grace, we gather tonight in the shadow of your cross, conscious of all of the things in this world that are not of you, mindful of our faults, our failings. Mindful of the ways that we have been part of the triumph of the world's brokenness. We gather with Mary in her grief, Peter in his denial, the soldier in his ignorance, and Magdalene in never giving up hope. As our prayers guide us through your anguish, may we offer our gratitude that you promise to never leave us to face our troubles alone. In Jesus' name, we humbly pray. Amen.
Oh. In an effort at honesty, let us confess our sins. Brothers and sisters, we are called to be children of grace and not children of sin. Let us take a moment of silence to approach the throne of grace that we may receive mercy. Let us pray. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry and too real to hide. Forgive what our lips tremble to name and what our hearts can no longer bear. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed. And grant us grace to grow evermore in your image and likeness. Through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen. And now these words of pardon. This is the message we have heard from Christ and proclaim to you. In Christ, you are forgiven. We experience Christ's power not by force or coercion, but through the forgiveness of all sins by grace. In the calming of our spirits by his love, and by inspiring our actions by his example. May we accept this freedom by living transformed lives. Amen.
Who believes what we've heard and seen? Who would have thought God's saving power would look like this? The servant grew up before God, a scrawny seedling, a scrubby plant, and a parched field. There was nothing attractive about him, nothing to cause us to take a second look. He was looked down on and passed over, a man who suffered, who knew pain firsthand. One look at him and people turned away. We looked down on him, thought he was scum. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, like a sheep that before it shears is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice, he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future, for he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of the people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth.
Then Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers, together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees. And they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "For whom are you looking?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them.
Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, in whose house the scribes and the elders had gathered. But Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest. Going inside, he sat with the guards in order to see how this would end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for false testimony against Jesus, so that they might put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last, two came forward and said, "This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and to build it in 3 days.'" The high priest stood up and said, "Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?" But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him, "I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." Jesus said to him, "You have said so, but I tell you, from now on you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has blasphemed. Why do we still need witnesses? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your verdict?" They answered, "He deserves death." Then they spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying, "Prophesy to us, you Messiah. Who is it that struck you?"
Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said, "This man also was with him." But he denied it, saying, "Woman, I do not know him." A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said, "You are one of them too." But Peter said, "Man, I am not." About an hour later, yet another kept insisting, "Surely this man also was with him, for he is a Galilean." But Peter said, "Man, I do not know what you are talking about." At that moment, while he was still speaking, the clock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, and how he had said to him, "Before the clock crows today, you will deny me 3 times. He went out and wept bitterly.
Shh. Shortly thereafter, the assembly rose as a body and brought Jesus before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying, "We found this man perverting our nation, forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king." Pilate then called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was perverting the people. And here I have examined him in your presence and have not found this man guilty of any of your charges against him. Neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has done nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him." Then they all shouted out together, "Away with this fellow! Release Barabbas for us!" Barabbas was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection and for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" A third time, Pilate said to them, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found in him no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him." But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over as they wished.
Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort. They clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him and began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. They offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it.
Two others, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." They cast lots to divide his clothing. The people stood by, watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, God's chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up, offering him sour wine, saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him, saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? We have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus replied, truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise.
Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother, and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, woman, here is your son. Then he said to the disciple, here is your mother. From that hour, the disciple took her into his own home.
When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, listen, he's calling for Elijah. Someone ran, filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to Jesus to drink, saying, let's see if Elijah comes to take him down. At that point, Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last, and the temple curtain was torn in two from top to bottom. Then the centurion who was standing guard, when he saw the way that Jesus breathed his last, said, truly this man was God's son.